بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه ما بعد. This is our 79th lesson going through the book Umdat Ahkaam من كلام خير الأنام صلى الله عليه وسلم وثب عبد الغني المقدسي رحمه الله تعالى. الحمد لله في قبريته كتاب الحدود. And we now move on to the next chapter, كتاب الأيمان والنذور. الأيمان جمع يمين. It is essentially oath. And the classical example for it is somebody says, والله I'm not going to speak to you. And he does it in a serious manner. طيب. And so this individual, when he does that, this yameen is mun'aqida. And so if this individual was to break that oath, then he should come with an expiation. Right? An expiation is mentioned in the Quran, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَلَكِنْ يُؤَخِذُكُمْ بِمَا عَاقَدْتُمُ الْأَيْمَانِ وَفِي قِرَاءَةٍ بِمَا عَاقَدْتُمُ الْأَيْمَانِ فَكَفَّارَتُهُ its كفارة إطعام عشرة مساكين is to feed 10 poor individuals. إطعام عشرة مساكين من أوسط ما تطعمون أهليكم, from the average amount of food or from the average quality of food that you feed your children and your family. من أوسط ما تطعمون أهليكم أو كسوتهم, to clothe 10 people. أو تحرير رقبة, or to free a slave. And all of the عبادات are عبادات مالية. They are all عبادات مالية. And so if a person was to make an oath, مثلا, he said, والله, I'm not going to speak to you. And then he speaks to you. Then this person, مثلا, let's say he wants to speak to you. He said, والله, I'm not going to speak to you. And then he wants to speak to you. For him to speak to you, he can do that and then come with an act that is act مالية or an act بدنية. But if he wants to put the kafara before the actual breaking of the expiation, مثلا, he said, والله, I'm not going to speak to you. And then he intends to speak to you. But he knows that if he speaks to you, he breaks his oath. And so he goes and he breaks his oath by coming with a kafara first, then he breaks it. And the only kafara that is mujzi in this scenario is the ibadat maliyah, the wealth-based worship. And so the wealth-based kafara, which is the first three that I mentioned, إطعام عشرة مساكين, أو كسوتهم, أو تحرير رقبة. The one who can't find all of this, then he has to break his oath and then perform the صيام ثلاثة أيام. طيب. The first hadith, وعن عبد الرحمن بن سمرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا عبد الرحمن بن سمرة لا تسأل الإمارة فإنك إن أعطيتها عن مسألة وكلت إليها وإن أعطيتها عن غير مسألة أعنت عليها وإذا حلفت على يمين فرأيت غيرها خيرا منها فخفر عن يمينك وأتي الذي هو خير. And so this hadith, it shows us and it benefits us, number one, that we shouldn't go after seeking positions of authority. However, this is conditional on the person who is challenging or the person who's going to take up that position of authority is a salih. If the person is going to take up that position of authority is a person who is known to be a taqi, known to be a God-fearing man, then there is no problem. You shouldn't challenge him for that position. But if the person is going to take up that position of authority is somebody who is not a salih, somebody who is not fit for that position, then you have to challenge him for it. You have to challenge him for it. And you don't say, qada, I don't like it, this and that. La. Because the potential harm that's going to come from this individual who's going to assume this position, who does not have the qualifications for this position, and he's a fasiq or a fajr or maybe even a kafir, طيب, and he's somebody who doesn't have any care for the Muslimi, and he's taking this position, whereas you're just avoiding that position because you don't want to take it, you have to take it up on the chin, take that position, and prevent this kafir or this fasiq or this fajr from taking up that position of authority. And as for the shahid or this hadith, the reason why this hadith is brought under this specific chapter is what I mentioned previously. In that, when a person makes an oath and then he sees something better than it, then he should expiate. He should do an expiation. And we mentioned the expiation for al-yameen, kafarat al-yameen, which is the four points that I mentioned. The first three, which is the asl, إطعام عشرة مساكين أو كسوتهم أو تحرير رقبة. The one who can't find any of that, then he is to fast 3 days. And we mentioned if you fast 3 days, or if you don't have the means to perform the first three or one of the first three, then you fast the 3 days. In order for you to be able to fast those 3 days, you have to break your yameen first and then fast the 3 days. But if you are able to feed 10 misakeen, or you're able to clothe them in any way, and you know, when we say clothe them, it doesn't matter how you clothe them. Even if you give them a imama, or you give them socks, or you give them shoes, it doesn't matter. Any way in which you clothe them, it doesn't matter. Whether you clothe a young child or an old man, it doesn't matter. طيب. Or تحرير رقبة, freeing a slave. And so these three, if you were to do it, you can do it first before breaking your oath. So you can do those acts first and then break the oath. So for example, you say, Wallahi, I won't speak to you, but then you want to speak to that person. Before you speak to them, you perform those three acts, and then you speak to the person, there is no problem with that. As for the next hadith, وعن أبي موسى رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إني والله إن شاء الله لا أحلف على يمين فأرى غيرها خيرا منها إلا أتيت الذي هو خير وتحللتها. So this hadith is essentially what we mentioned in the previous hadith, that من حلف على يمين فرأى غيرا خيرا فرأى غيرها خيرا منها فليكفر عن يمينه وليأتي الذي هو خير. And as for the hadith after that, عن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله ينهاكم أو إن الله ينهاكم عن إن الله ينهاكم أن تحلفوا بآبائكم ولمسلم فمن كان حالفا فليحلف بالله أو ليصمت. وفي رواية قال عمر فوالله ما حلفت بها منذ سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ينهى عنها ذاكرا ولا آثرا. آثرا means حاكيا عن غيري أنه حلف بها. So this hadith shows us the prohibition of swearing by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that swearing by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is from a shirk al-asghar, and that if a person was to continuously fall into swearing by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it could potentially lead him to going into exaggeration and extreme veneration and ta'zim for this individual that he is swearing by, which is other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which could potentially lead him to major shirk. And so whoever wants to swear, then swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't swear by the Kaaba, don't swear by your mom's life, don't swear by your father, don't swear by any of these things. Why? Because it's very, very dangerous, and the Messenger of Allah prohibited it. And Umar radiallahu anhu, look how he was mutaharriyan li sunnati nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look how much he followed the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he heard that the Messenger of Allah prohibited it, khalas. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمَرًا يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَارَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. This is what Umar ibn Khattab applied. He said, I never since that day swore by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abadan. La in a way of just mentioning it. For example, if I'm mentioning a story and somebody is swearing by other than Allah, I'm not even going to say it there. So he was kind of mutaharriyan li sunnati an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam radiallahu anhu wa arda. And as for the one who swears by other than Allah, فَيَمِينُهُ لَيَنْعَقِدْ. This oath that he's made does not come into action. It is not binding upon him if he swears by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ كَفَّارَةً. And there is no expiation upon this individual who swears by other than Allah عز وجل. As for the hadith follows, وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال قال سليمان بن داود عليهما السلام لا أطوفن الليلة على 70 مرة. لا أطوفن means I'm going to go around 70 of my wives and have intercourse with them. أجامعهن تجد كل امرأة منهن غلاما يقاتل في سبيل الله. That each of these women, after I have intercourse with them, they will all give birth to one young boy or one child who will fight in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فقيل له, said to him, قل إن شاء الله, say إن شاء الله, فلم يقول فأطاف بهن فلن تلد منهن إلا امرأة واحدة نصف إنسان. So he never said inshallah, he was reminded to say, but he never said it. And so when he went and he did that action, and shows you the strength of the Messenger alayhi ma salam, that they had the strength of 30 men, كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أعطيته قوة 30. When he was able to do what? أن يجامع امرأته أن يجامع نساءه التسعة في ليلة واحدة, which the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم he did. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لو قال إن شاء الله لم يحنث وكان دركا لحاجته. وقوله وقيل له قل إن شاء الله يعني قال له الملك. And so here what we learn is the main benefit, which is linked back to the chapter title, is that the one who makes a hadith, the one who swears by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or who makes an oath, then he says إن شاء الله, then this yameen does not become binding upon him. I.e. لا كفارة علي. لا كفارة علي. So if somebody says wallahi inshaAllah, so he says wallahi by Allah, if Allah wills, then this is not yameen, this is not an oath that a person has taken, with the condition however that the inshaAllah is intended, that the inshaAllah is intended, and that it's connected in the speech and in the oath that you're giving. And so you say wallahi inshaAllah I'm going to Vancouver, wallahi inshaAllah I'm going to Vancouver مثلا. طيب, I'm going to go to Vancouver. Wallahi, inshaAllah, I'm going to go to Vancouver. مثلا, this individual, لم يأتي بيمين. His يمين لا ينعقد. Why? Because he said, Wallahi, أذن inshaAllah. And he intended the inshaAllah. He intended the inshaAllah. So inshaAllah, essentially, like you could say, a cancelling. It's a something that cancels the yameen that you take. So Sulaiman ibn Dawood, he made an oath. He said, I am going to. This is an oath which he's making. لَأَطُوفَنَّ اللَّيْلَةَ عَلَى سَبْعِينَ مَرَّةً إِمْرَأَةً. I'm going to go and I'm going to have intercourse with 70 of my wives. And all of them will give birth to what? Will give birth to one child. So I'm going to have 70 children who are going to fight in the way of Allah. That's his oath that he made. However, he never said inshaAllah. And so the messenger of Allah, he said, لَوْ قَالَ inshaAllah, if he had said inshaAllah, لَمْ يَحْنَثْ, his oath would not have broken. وَكَانَ دَرَكًا لِحَاجَتِهِ, and his whatever he was requesting, whatever he wanted, he would reach it. And his goal that he wanted, which was to get 70 young men who would fight in the way of Allah, he would have reached it. وَلَكِنُّ لَمْ يُدْرِكْ حَاجَتَهُ. Why? لِأَنُّهُ لَمْ يَقُلْ إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ. He never said, if Allah wills. And so what did Allah say in the Quran? إِنِّي وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهِ. Don't say, I'm going to do something tomorrow. Rather, always attach to it, inshaAllah. And so don't say, wallahi, I'm going to do something tomorrow. If you say, wallahi, I'm going to do something tomorrow, or wallahi, I'm going to fast tomorrow, then this is what? A yameen that you have made. You have to come with it. It's mun'aqidah. It is a binding oath that you have made. طيب. However, if you say, wallahi, inshaAllah, and you mean the inshaAllah, and it's muttasiratun bil kalam, then yameenuka lam yan'aqid. Your oath has not become binding upon you. And so if you were to break it, لم تحنث. If you were to break it, ليس عليك كفارة. There is no kafara upon you. So if you say, wallahi, inshaAllah, I'm going to fast tomorrow, and you don't fast tomorrow, then you haven't broken your oath. فليس عليك كفارة في هذا الموضع. However, because Sulaiman never said inshaAllah, لم يدرك حاجته. And so this shows the importance of saying inshaAllah, and always saying that, because everything under the mashia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and everything occurs due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will. تبارك الأسماءه وجلت صفاته. And this also, another benefit we learn from this hadith is مصاحبة الصالحين. That if you are to be with the pious ones, then they will always remind you of khayr. They will always remind you of good. Look how the malak, the angel, who was accompanying Sulaiman, reminded him of khayr, reminded him of good. However, if you're with those who are the negligent ones, those who are not pious, those who are not reminding you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that's what they're going to do. They're not going to remind you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're going to force you to fall into sins and ma'asi. فَالْمَرْءُ عَلَى دِينِ خَلِيلِهِ فَيَنْظُرْ أَحَدُكُمْ مَنْ يُخَالِلْ كَمَا قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. And so look at those who you take as companions, because your companions will always have a rubber, will always have an impact and an effect upon you. As for the next hadith, عن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من حلف على يمين صبر يقتطع بها مال امرئ مسلم هو فيها فاجر لقي الله عليه غضبان. ونزلت قوله تعالى إن الذين يشترون بعهد الله وأيمانهم ثمنا قليلا. The أيمان يا إخوان, the oaths that a person can take could be of three types. يمين لغو وليس عليها شيء لا يؤاخذكم الله باللغو في أيمانكم. لغو اليمين is an oath that a person takes without actually intending it, without it being binding upon him. And it's something which is common, especially among our people. Somebody says, wallahi this, wallahi that, wallahi this, wallahi that. But he doesn't actually mean wallahi. He doesn't actually mean it. Rather, it's just from his language. It's from his vocab. طيب. فهذا يسمى يمين لغو. One shouldn't say it regularly. He shouldn't teach his tongue to say it regularly, because wallahi is something which carries weight. However, it's يمين لغو. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, لا يأخذكم الله باللغو في أيمانكم. So that one is forgiven, and there is no kafara upon it, because it's not something which you actually what? عقدت عليه. It's not something which you said with conviction, with intent, طيب, with a purpose behind it. The second is يمين المنعقد, a yameen which actually is binding. And that's the yameen which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, ولكن يأخذكم بما عاقدتم الأيمان. Those أيمان منعقدة, that you are saying it with intent and purpose. Wallahi, I'm saying it with purpose now, with intent. I actually mean what I'm saying. I actually mean this oath that I'm taking. طيب. So that's the second type of yameen, وهو منعقد. So if you break that, عليك كفارة. If you break that, then upon you is a كفارة. And this كفارة, you mentioned it previously. إطعام عشرة مساكين أو كسوتهم أو تحرير رقبة فمن لم يجد فصيام ثلاثة أيام ذلك كفارة أيمانكم إذا حلفتم واحفظوا أيمانكم. As for the third, then it is يمين الغموس. And يمين الغموس or يمين صبر, it is from the كبائر, from the major sins. It's from the major sins. And the reason why it's called يمين الغموس, لأن الشخص يغمس في نار جهنم, he'll be completely immersed into the hellfire. And so this shows the severity of يمين الغموس. And يمين الغموس, the best way to explain it is as the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he did. وَهُوَ يَقْتَطِعُ بِهَا مَالَ مِرْءٍ مُسْلِمٍ. And so let's say I stole this iPhone from Fulan. I stole this iPhone from Fulan. And so it's under my possession. So when we come to the Qadi from the apparent, he sees the iPhone in my possession. He sees the iPhone in my possession. And so the one who I stole this iPhone from, طيب, the iPhone is not in his possession. And so I'm in a strong position and he's in a weak position. In order for him to take or to turn his weak position to a strong position, he has to come with proof, evidence. البينات على المدعي واليمين على من أنكر, right? And so now the brother, he comes and he says, this guy stole my iPhone. And he doesn't have evidence for it. So who's in the stronger position here? I'm in the stronger position. All I have to do is I have to swear by Allah that it's mine. However, when I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this scenario, remember, this is not mine, I've stolen it. اقتضعت بها مالا من المسلمين. And so I swore by Allah, this is يمين غموس. And this is the yameen which is the kabair. This is the kabira. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَشْتَرُونَ بِعَهْدِ اللَّهِ وَأَيْمَانِهِمْ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا أُولَئِكَ لَا خَلَاقَ لَهُمْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا يُكَلِّمَهُمُ اللَّهِ وَلَا يَنظُرُ إِلَيْهِمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَلَا يُزَكِيهِمْ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. And so those who buy, يَشْتَرُونَ بِعَهْدِ اللَّهِ, they buy with the covenant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and with their ايمان, with their oath, ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا, a small price. For example, this iPhone. And so what I have done in this case is I have come with يمين الغموس. وهذه من الكبائر, from the major sins. فاحذرها. So be warned from it. And you will meet Allah وهو عليه غضبان. You will meet Allah and Allah is angry with you if you fall into this. So if I was to do this, if I was to, now this brother, I stole money from him, and we come to the Qadi, and the Qadi says, okay, this individual is claiming that the money that I have is mine, is his. Where is your evidence? He doesn't have the evidence. And I say now, wallahi, it's mine, but I know that I stole this money from him, that it actually does belong to him. Then I have come with يمين الغموس وهذه من الكبائر. As for the next hadith, عن الأشعث بن قيس رضي الله عنه قال كان بيني وبين رجل خصومة في بئر فاختصمنا إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم شاهداك أو يمينه. قلت إذا يحلف ولا يبالي. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من حلف على يمين صبر يقطع بها مال امرئ مسلم وهو فيها فاجر نقي الله عليه غضبان. And so this hadith, it explains what the statement of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم means in terms of the context. الأشعث بن قيس and a man fought over a well. And so they came to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And so the Messenger of Allah clearly applied the principle which is لو يعطى الناس بدعواهم لدعى رجالا قو لدعى رجال لدعى رجال لدعى رجال أموال قوم ودماءهم لكن البينة على المدعي واليمين على من أنكر. So if two people come, one person has the possession of the iPhone and the other one doesn't, but this other one is claiming that the iPhone belongs to him. طيب, this person is claiming that the iPhone belongs to him. So the one who's claiming is the مدعى, is or the مدعي, the one who's claiming, and the one who's actually got possession of the iPhone, the accused, هو المدعى عليه. And so the مدعي is the one who's supposed to come with the evidence. فالبينة على المدعي, the one who's claiming, because he's in a weaker position, because we always judge people based upon the ظاهر. The ظاهر here is that the phone is in the possession of the مدعى عليه. So you as the مدعي, you as the claimant, you have to come with evidence. If you don't come with evidence, then the ruling is to be given to the one who has been accused, if he swears by Allah. However, let's say the one who is the مدعي doesn't have evidence, and it truly does belong to him. The مدعى عليه has to take into consideration that when you come with your يمين, when you say, wallahi, it belongs to me, this يمين is يمين غموس. And if it's يمين غموس, you will meet Allah وهو عليك غضبان. لأنك اقطعت مال امرئ مسلم بغير حق أنت فيها فاجر أي كاذب. طيب. And so this shows us the severity of يمين الغموس. And so this is why, even if the person doesn't have evidence, even if the person, the claimant, doesn't have evidence, the one who's claiming doesn't have evidence, the مدعى عليه, the one who's being accused, has to be informed that, أخي, watch out. When you make this يمين, you are going to be potentially falling into يمين الغموس. Because if it doesn't truly belong to you and it does belong to him, then know that you will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وهو عليك غضبان. And the only way in which you're able to save yourself from that, for example, let's say somebody, he fell into يمين الغموس, the only way in which you're able to save yourself from that, number one, أن تتوب إلى الله, to return to Allah in repentance, and to return the mal, to return that money which you stole, which you took بغير حق, to its صاحب, to the one who owns it. That's the only way in which you're going to be safe from meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without him being in the state of anger with you. طيب أنا أسفل أن أتحدث عن ثابت بن الضحاك الأنصاري رضي الله عنه أنه بايع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تحت شجرة، وأن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: من حلف على يمين بملة غير الإسلام كافرا متعمدا فهو كما قال، ومن قتل نفسه بشيء عذر به يوم القيامة، وليس على رجل نذر فيما لا يملك. وفي رواية: ولعن المؤمنين كقتله. وفي رواية: من ادعى دعوة كاذبة ليتكثر بها لم يجده الله إلا قلة. فليس حديث الثابت بن الضحاك says that he gave the pledge of the messenger. He pledged the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He gave his oath of allegiance to the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم underneath the tree. Of course, قال الله تعالى. He references Allah سبحانه وتعالى references this in the Quran. لقد رضي الله عن المؤمنين إذ يبايعونك تحت الشجرة فعلم ما في قلوبهم فأنزل السكينة عليهم وأثابهم فتحا قريبا. So we can be certain that Allah is pleased with Al-Thabit ibn al-Dhahhak al-Ansari رضي الله عنه, because he's from those who gave the pledge of allegiance to the messenger of Allah تحت الشجرة, as Allah سبحانه وتعالى mentioned, لقد رضي الله عن المؤمنين إذ يبايعونك تحت الشجرة فعلم ما في قلوبهم. And this of course occurred in the sixth year of the Hijrah and before the Sulh of Al-Hudaybiyyah. And so the Messenger of Allah said a few things during this period. The first, من حلف على يمين بملة غير الإسلام كاذبا متعمدا فهو كما قال. The classical example for this is someone says, I am a Jew if I don't do this. Or I am a Kafir if I do this. Or I am a Hindu if I don't do this. Rather common, right? It's very common that people do this today. So the one has to avoid this. وهذا من الكبائر. This is from the major sins, and someone has to avoid, and you have to avoid this. Why? فهو كما قال. Then he is like he is كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. And that's a very, very dangerous statement, and a very, very dangerous thing to say for a person to fall into. And so when you want to swear, احلف بالله, swear by Allah. That's it. Don't come with these types of شبهات, or these types of doubtful statements like I'm a Jew if I don't do this. Because if you don't do this, what's going to happen? If you don't do this, what's going to happen? And so the person should avoid this. And of course, if he does this, فَيَمِينُهُ لَا يَنْعَقِدْ وَلَا كَفَارَةَ عَلَيْهِ. And as for the next point, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, وَمَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسَهُ بِشَيْءٍ عُذِرَ بِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. That the one who kills himself with something, for example, if somebody stabbed himself or threw himself from a tree or from a building, then he will be punished with it on the Day of Judgment. And the shahid of this hadith, وَلَيْسَ عَلَى رَجُلٍ نَذْرٌ فِي مَا لَا يَمْلِكُ. And the person cannot make a vow on something that he doesn't own. For example, somebody says, I vow to slaughter my brother's sheep. That sheep does not belong to you. And so you cannot make that vow. And that vow does not become binding, because you're making a vow on something which you do not own. And as for other riwayat for this hadith, وَلَعْنُ الْمُؤْمِنِ قَتْلِهِ. To curse a believer is like to kill him. Because when you curse a believer, you're saying, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala distance you away from his mercy. And so that is something which you have to avoid. It's as if you've killed him. So we should avoid cursing other believers. And in another riwayah, وَمَنْ اِدَّعَى دَعْوَى كَاذِبَةً لِيَتَكَثَّرَ بِهَا لَمْ يَجِدْهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا قِلَّةً. So the one who makes a claim, and this is very, very important, because we can look at it from two angles. The first angle is, let's say somebody claims that this money belongs to him, when it doesn't actually belong to him. Rather, this is a lie. Then the reason why he's doing this is so that he can get more money. So he claims, so he's a continuous claimer. So he goes to the Qadi continuously claiming other people's wealth, and he continuously wins these cases. Then know that this person is going to be nothing but in a state of decrease, and in a state of he'll be continuously كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يزده الله إلا قلة, that Allah will not increase him except in that which is small. طيب لم يزد الله ولا قلة, i.e. he'll be humiliated, he'll be in a state of humiliation, he will be belittled. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not increase him except in belittlement. طيب. And the next way, or the second way in which we can look at this hadith, is من ادعى دعوة كاذبة, the one who claims something that isn't his. For example, he performs the act of plagiarism مثلا, and so he steals the works of others. And so another person does all of the work, and he just comes and he steals it, and he claims it to be his. Somebody put all of that research effort in and did all of that work, and you just come right at the last minute and just steal that work and claim it as yours and get all of the rewards from it. We find this common in the academic circles today. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. And so likewise, you fall under this hadith. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. We've come to the end of the sub-chapter. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.